This is Steps to Life Television, proclaiming the soon coming of Jesus and urging men everywhere to be ready. Stay tuned as Dr. Grossball dips into God's Word and gives us the water of life.
Happy to be able to worship the Lord with you again this week. Evelyn and I were in West Palm Beach, Florida last week, and we had a very inspiring and interesting weekend there with the believers, and a wonderful work is being done in that part of the world, not only in South Florida, but also they're reaching out into the Caribbean, and they have goals to reach in the entire Spanish-speaking world in Central America and South America. And one of their great burdens that I would like to invite you to pray for, they told me, they said, we have to have landmarks in Spanish. She said, we have to have it. And so the Lord's going to help us to accomplish that. And it's wonderful to know that no matter what the devil does, God's work is going forward all over the world today. It's exciting. Because the Bible says that when the gospel is preached in all the world to a witness for all nations, what's going to happen then? The end's going to come. That's what it says in Matthew 24:14. Jesus is going to come. And when we see that the Lord is working miracles all over the world to get the gospel finished and preached in every part of the world, we know that we are rapidly approaching the end. Isn't it exciting, the day in which we're living? When I was a senior in college, I went to church one Sabbath, and the speaker was the president of the North Pacific Union Conference. His name was Hackett. His last name was Hackett. And he entitled his remarks for this worship service, The Law of the Unenforceable. I thought, well, what in the world is that? So I listened to try to figure out what he was talking about and what he had in mind. And a few days later, I was in a college classroom, and the teacher brought up this sermon, and he didn't like it. And what he didn't like about it was he said, how can you have a law? Is it really a law if you can't enforce it? And I've thought about that many times since then. And I want to ask you this question, see what you think about it. Is there such a thing as a law that cannot be enforced? Is there a law that cannot be enforced? I have come to the conclusion that there not only is one, but that there are many. In fact, I have found evidence since that time that churches make laws that they can't enforce. Families make laws that they can't enforce. Governments make laws that they can't enforce. Schools make laws that they can't enforce. Unenforceable laws are all over the world. However, people say, well, the only reason they can't enforce them is because they're not strong enough. They're not powerful enough. If they were strong enough, and if they were powerful enough, and if they had enough information and they had enough power, they could enforce those laws. Well, then let me ask you a harder question. Does God have a law that cannot be enforced? Oh no, somebody says, God can enforce anything. Well, now be careful. Don't answer too quick. I want to read to you a few sentences from the first chapter of a book called Desire of Ages. And it says, in the light from Calvary, it will be seen that the law of self-renouncing love is the law of life for earth and heaven. That the love which seeks not her own has its source in the heart of God, and that in the meek and lowly one is manifested the character of him who dwells in light which no man can approach unto. Now, what does it say is going to be seen in the light from Calvary? That the, it calls it what? Calls it a law. And what is the law? It's the law of self-renouncing love. And it's going to be seen that this law is the law of what? It's the law of life. It's the law that you have to be in harmony with if you want to have life. That is the law. It's the law of self-renouncing love. That's the law of life. You have that book, you might want to look in that chapter on pages 20 and 21 and 22 this afternoon. She then goes on to expound on that concept, that principle, to show and to demonstrate by many illustrations that that is the law of life for the entire universe. Well, now then I have this question for you again. If that is the law of life for the universe, can that law be enforced? Well, let me read to you again from Desire of Ages, page 22. The earth was dark through misapprehension of God, that the gloomy shadows might be lightened, that the world might be brought back to God. Satan's deceptive power was to be broken. This could not be done by force. The exercise of force is contrary to the principles of God's government. Now just let that sink in. Can that law be enforced? No, it cannot. It cannot be enforced because the use of force is contrary to the principles of God's government, but there are other reasons than that. It says in the next part of the sentence, He, that is God, desires only the service of love, and love cannot be commanded. It cannot be won by force or authority. See, some people think, I remember in 1967, I went to Battle Creek, Michigan. It's the only time in my whole life I saw a president of the United States in person. And Lyndon Johnson was speaking there, and I was very interested to listen to his speech. I say this not disrespectfully of the man, but just as a matter of fact, he gave me the impression in that speech that he thought that you could cure every single problem in this world with money. If you have enough money, enough power, enough authority, then you can solve the problems. That's the way people think. But what did we just read here? God desires only the service of love. And love, you cannot gain the service of love by giving a command. You cannot gain it by the use of force. And you cannot gain it by the use of authority. Well, how are you going to get it? How can God win the service of love from His creatures if He has all the force and authority He needs, but you can't get it that way? Notice what it goes on to say. It says, only by love is love awakened. Last year, I was preaching along these general lines in California, and I preached a sermon on the fifth commandment. And I've never preached that sermon here, so I'd like to go over some of the things that we studied in that sermon when I was preaching in California on the fifth commandment. And I'll tell you beforehand that these topics, this subject is so big that every time I study it, I feel like it's a mind-stretching type of study to try to comprehend the principles that we're dealing with. Now remember what we just studied. When we look at Calvary, what do we see as the law of life for the whole universe? What is it? It's the law of self-sacrifice, self-renouncing love is the law of life. And the way sin came in is because the devil rejected that principle and he began to seek for himself instead of to seek for the good of others. In fact, let's just read a few sentences on that because it has directly to do with what I want to introduce to you from the fifth commandment. And this is also in the first chapter of Desire of Ages. It's right in the middle of a section that we just skipped over when we read the other sentences. Here's what it says. In heaven itself, this law was broken. That is the law of self-sacrifice or self-renouncing love. Sin originated in self-seeking. Lucifer, the covering cherub, desired to be first in heaven. He sought to gain control of heavenly beings, to draw them away from their Creator and to win their homage to himself. So Lucifer wanted to gain control over the heavenly beings and win their homage to himself instead of to God. And so how did he attempt to do this? Notice how he did it. She explains how he did it. This is very important to understand with what we're going to study, because he's still trying to do the same thing today. It says, therefore, he misrepresented God, attributing to him the desire for self-exaltation. With his own evil characteristics, he sought to invest the loving Creator. Thus he deceived angels. Thus he deceived men. He led them to doubt the Word of God and to distrust his goodness. Because God is a God of justice and terrible majesty, Satan caused them to look upon him as severe and unforgiving. Thus he drew men to join him in rebellion against God, and the night of woe settled down upon the world. So what did the devil do that deceived angels and deceived men, and it caused a night of woe to settle down upon the world? What did he do? He misrepresented the character of God. Now let's just think through that. When he misrepresented the character of God, he said, God is like this. But God wasn't like that at all. Now I'm going to read for you in a moment a statement from Volume 5, Testimonies for the Church, page 738, that tells how the devil is still doing that. And it mentions three characteristics that are characteristics of the devil himself, but he makes people think that God is this way. But first, let's read the fifth commandment. If you have your Bible, I invite you to open it to Exodus 20. Exodus 20, verse 12, says, honor your father and your mother, that your days may be long upon the land which the Lord your God is giving you. Now, in order to understand the spiritual meaning of this commandment, perhaps we should look to the book of Malachi. Look to Malachi, the first chapter, the last book in the Old Testament. All society, the family, all institutions, the church, the business world, government, everything in our world, all society is built on the principle of honor and respect. Now, we have many other things to study today, so I'm not going to take time to give proofs for that. You can study that out on yourself, for yourself. All society, especially the family, is built on the concept of honor and respect. And if you lose that, your family is going to disintegrate. And you may still live in the same house, but your family is going to disintegrate. Your church will disintegrate. May still be in the same building. Society will disintegrate. It's all built on the principle of honor and respect. And notice what it says here in Malachi 1:6. It says, a son honors his father, and a servant his master. This is the Lord speaking. If then I am the father, where is my honor? And if I am a master, where is my reverence? Says the Lord of hosts. To you priests who despise my name, yet you say, in what way have we despised your name? So, all society is built on the principle of honor and respect. However, very often. Honor and respect is confused with authority. Perhaps we'll look at that in a moment. But first of all, I want to read to you this statement that explains how the devil gets everything turned around 180 degrees so that what people think about God is actually true of the devil and not true of God at all. This is from Volume 5, Testimonies for the Church, page 738. It says, the Creator has been presented to their minds as clothed with the attributes of the Prince of Evil himself. Now let's think this through. The God of heaven has been presented to people's minds as clothed in the attributes of the devil. So that what people think God is like is what the devil is like, not what God is like at all. Now, she's going to go on and tell you what these attributes of Satan are, and people think that that this is the way God is, but it's not. Even Christians think that God is this way. And what you think God is like affects everything in your daily life, in your family, in your job, your behavior. Your whole concept, your whole outlook on life is affected by what you think God is like. And what people think God is like is really what the devil is like. That's what we just read. Now, what are the attributes of the devil that people think that God is that way? But God's not that way at all. The devil's that way. Okay, here's what they are. Three things. We'll continue reading. The Creator has been presented to their minds as clothed with the attributes of the Prince of Evil himself as arbitrary, that's one, severe, that's two, and unforgiving, that's three. And why does the devil present God in that kind of a light? So, it says, that he, that is God, might be feared, shunned, and even hated by men. Let's look at attribute number one first. The first attribute of the devil. Now remember, this is satanic, what we're looking at. It has nothing to do with God. It's satanic. It's one of the principles of Satan's character. And Satan is arbitrary. Now let's just think through what that is. We need to understand what we're talking about. What is arbitrary authority? Arbitrary authority is authority that is based on position or power. Just think that through. Arbitrary authority is authority that is based on position or power. You do it because I told you so, and I am an officer of whatever. So therefore, you have to do it. Whether it makes any sense or not, or whether it's reasonable or not, doesn't matter. You do it because I told you so. That's arbitrary authority. That is satanic. Don't ever forget that. That is satanic. Do you know, friends, that God has never, ever, in all eternity in the past, and He never will in all eternity in the future, ever do one arbitrary thing? People think He does. Even in the insurance policy, it talks about acts of God. People think that God is arbitrary. The devil's convinced them of that. And they've been told, well, God could do anything He wants to. That's truth and error all mixed up together. But God has never, ever done one arbitrary thing. God doesn't come to people and say, you have to do this because I'm more powerful than you. That's not the way it works. That's the devil's program. You have to do this because I'm the Creator and you're the creature, and therefore you have to do it. That's not the way God works. That's arbitrary. Well, somebody says, doesn't God have authority? Well, of course He does. He has what no one else in the whole universe has. He has absolute authority. Well, then somebody says, Pastor John, I can't figure this out. If God doesn't ever do anything arbitrary, His authority is not based on His position or His power, and yet He has absolute authority, how can that work out? How does that work? Well, The next question is then, what kind of authority does God have? Okay, here's the answer. That's not a trick question. It's an answer we should all know. God's authority is moral. God has moral authority, not arbitrary authority. Now let's think through what that means. Take your Bible. Let's look up, first of all, Genesis 18. This is brought to light right in the first book of the Bible. But we'll look many texts in the writings of Moses. Genesis 18, look at verse 23. Abraham understood this. And Abraham thought he was getting in an argument with the Lord. He couldn't imagine that the Lord would do what he thought he was going to do. He couldn't imagine that God would do anything like that. And so it says in verse 23, it says, Abraham came near and said, would you also destroy the righteous with the wicked? Verse 25, far be it from you to do such a thing as this, to slay the righteous with the wicked, so that the righteous should be as the wicked. Far be it from you, shall not the judge of all the earth do right? You see, moral has to do with right and wrong. That's why we call the Ten Commandments the moral law. Moral has to do with right and wrong. The Ten Commandments define what is right and what is wrong. If it's in harmony with the Ten Commandments, it's right. It's moral. If it's out of harmony, it's wrong. It's immoral. God's authority is moral. It has to do with right and wrong. Let's read several more texts on this. Look in Deuteronomy 32. We're studying a very big concept, and if you can get in mind what we're studying about the character of God, it will change your entire life, and it will change your entire attitude toward the Bible and all inspired writings. Now, notice carefully what it says. Deuteronomy 32, verse 4. He is the rock. His work is perfect. For all his ways are justice. A God of truth and without injustice, righteous and upright is He. So, God's authority is moral. Let's read a few more texts in the book of Psalms that say this unequivocally, that's where His authority comes from. Look in Psalm 89, verse 14. God has a government. It's a kingdom. He's a king and He sits on a throne. And notice what the foundation of His throne or His government is. Psalm 89, verse 14. It says, righteousness and justice are the what? The foundation of your throne. Mercy and truth go before your face. Look over to Psalm 97, verse 2. It says, clouds and darkness surround Him. Righteousness and justice are the foundation of His throne. So what is the foundation of God's authority? It's His character. It's moral authority because it's based on His righteousness, His justice, His character. Maybe you want a text in the New Testament about the same thing. Look at Hebrews 1. Hebrews 1. Starting in verse 8. It says, but to the Son, He says, now this is the Father speaking to the Son, your throne, O God, is forever and ever, a scepter. Let's stop right there for a moment. What is a scepter? A scepter is a rod of authority. Now notice where God's authority comes from. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated lawlessness. Therefore, God, your God, has anointed you with the oil of gladness more than your companions. So God's authority is always moral. It's never arbitrary. Now, I understand that sometimes, those of you that are parents can understand this, sometimes when you're dealing with a two-year-old child, you ask them to do something or not to do something, and they can't understand all the reason for it. But does that mean that you don't have a reason? See, there are reasons that sometimes a two-year-old child can't understand. That doesn't mean that there isn't any. It just means that they can't understand it yet. It's the same way with us and God. Jesus called us little children. Sometimes God tells us to do something or not to do something, and we can't understand. And so people say, Pastor John, why does God ask me to do that? I can do that, and it won't hurt me at all. You ever heard somebody talk like that? Now remember, God never asks you to do anything that's arbitrary. There is always a moral reason behind anything that God asks you to do or not to do. And what is the moral reason? Now we're going to go to the book of Deuteronomy and see the reason behind everything that God asks His children either to do or not to do. Let's go to the book of Deuteronomy. We'll look at Deuteronomy 6 first. Deuteronomy 6, verse 24. And the Lord commanded us to observe all these statutes, to fear the Lord our God for our good. How many times? What's always mean? That He might preserve us alive as it is this day. When God tells you to do something or not to do something, what is the reason? It's for your good. How many times? Every single time. God never, ever gives an arbitrary command just because He wants you to do or not do something. It's for your good. How many times? Every single time. You see, God's authority is moral, always. He is not arbitrary like the devil paints Him out to be. Look over to Deuteronomy 10. Verses 12 and 13. And now, Israel, what does the Lord your God require of you? But to fear the Lord your God, to walk in all His ways, and to love Him, to serve the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, and to keep the commandments of the Lord and His statutes, which I command you today, for what reason? What is the reason? For your good. Everything in the law that God commands is for what reason? It's for your good. God is never arbitrary. Anything that God asks you to do or not to do, the reason is because He knows, you may not know yet. Just like a 2-year-old child may not know why his mother or father asked him to do or not do certain things. He may not know yet. But everything that God asks you to do is for your good. And if people could understand this, you know the pastors would have a lot less questions getting asked of them all the time. Why does God ask us to do this? Why does God tell us not to do that? I can't figure it out. Well, the pastor may not know either. But you know one thing, that if God asks you to do it or not to do it, there's a reason, there's a moral reason, and it's for whose good? It's for our good. Look at Deuteronomy 30. Verses 5 and 6. It says, Then the Lord your God will bring you to the land which your fathers possessed, and you shall possess it. He will prosper you and multiply you more than your fathers, and the Lord your God will circumcise your heart and the heart of your descendants to love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. For what reason? That you may what? That you may live. And Moses goes on to say, Now what I'm setting before you, it's your choice. I'm setting before you good and evil, and you can choose what you want. If you want to live, this is what you need to do. And if you don't want to live, if you want to die, then you can go contrary to this. In fact, in Proverbs, Jesus is speaking, and He says, All that hate me love death.
If you want to live, if you want what's good for yourself, this is the way to get it, to follow God's commandments, to do His will. That's what the book is for. That's what the inspired writings are for. So you can find out what God's will is and do it. And when you do it, what's going to happen to you? Good is going to result. Now, I hope you've seen sufficient proof in the Bible, because we're going to leave this point now, to see from the Bible that God's authority is always moral. It's never arbitrary. It is always moral. And His authority is based on His character. And He is a moral governor of the universe. Remember, moral has to do with right and wrong. Now we need to go to the next point that I already alluded to. God's authority is moral, not arbitrary. It has to do with right. His authority is based on His rightness, on His goodness, on His justice, on His righteousness. But God's authority also is absolute. He has absolute moral authority. And that is something that no other being in the whole universe has. Even the angels don't have it. And certainly no human being has it. Now, there's a lot of human beings that act sometimes like they have it, but they don't really have it. Only God has absolute moral authority. Now, let's think through why this is. There is a reason for this. And we can discover the reason in the Scriptures. God's authority, His moral authority, is absolute because, I'll state it for you in just a few words, many Scriptures could be read that will prove this. His moral authority is absolute because, number one, He is infinite in wisdom and knowledge. He is infinite in wisdom and knowledge. He doesn't make a mistake. You cannot have absolute authority if you're subject to making a mistake. That would be disaster. He is infinite in wisdom and knowledge. That's the first reason. But there is a second reason that His moral authority is absolute, and that is because His love is infinite, and His love is stronger than death. And the cross proves that. Nobody else, now I say this respectfully to all created intelligences, but we need to recognize the truth. Nobody else in the whole universe, not the church, did you get that? Not the church. Not clergy or ministers of the church. Not parents. Not husbands. Nobody else in the universe has absolute authority. Only God has that. And all real authority comes from God's moral authority. Any other authority is usurped. Now, there are many organizations in this world that have usurped authority that they don't really have, and they're going to lose it at the end of the world. They're going to lose it all. All real moral authority derives from God. It derives from God's moral authority, and there is no other real authority. We're going to look at the authority of Antichrist in a moment, but let's just look at a couple of Bible texts that make this very clear. Look, for instance, at Ephesians, the 6th chapter. Now, this is talking about the relationship of children to parents. And look at the first verse in Ephesians 6. You'll notice from the second verse, we are on the subject. We're talking about the fifth commandment. It says, children, obey your parents. Now, do parents have absolute authority over children? Well, now notice how it's worded. Children, obey your parents how? In the Lord. Now, remember where authority comes from. All moral authority derives from God. And God has written down what is moral and what is immoral in His Word. Now, let's think this through. I'm going to have to finish this tonight because I'm just getting started and we're almost out of time. But I will, the Lord, if I get a chance. Let's think through how this works. If I, as a father, if I command my children to do or not to do something, what is it that gives that command authority? Well, look back to Genesis again. Look in Genesis about the experience of Abraham. Genesis 18, verse 19. See, the only thing that many people understand about authority, all they've learned about in this world, is that authority comes from position and power. So if you're a policeman, if you're an officer, or Mao Zedong said that power comes out of the barrel of a gun. So if you have power, then you have authority. If you have position, you have authority. But moral authority derives from the character of God and from the moral authority of God. Notice what it says here in Genesis 18, verse 19. For I have known him, that is Abraham, in order that he may command his children and his household after them, after him, that they may keep the way of the Lord to do righteousness and justice, that the Lord may bring to Abraham what he has spoken to him. Abraham had authority. And why did he have authority? His authority derived from where? He commanded his household to do what? To keep the way of the Lord. And when he commanded his household to keep the way of the Lord, where does that authority come from? That comes from God's moral authority. That's where it comes from. That's where a pastor's authority comes from. Somebody says, does a pastor have divine authority? Well, if a pastor tells you something from the Word of God, that has divine authority. That is derived authority from the moral character of God and from God's authority. The same thing is true about the church. Have you ever heard of properly constituted church authority? You ever heard of that? Somebody says, you have to do what I say. You have to submit to what I say because I have properly constituted church authority. Well, what is properly constituted church authority? Remember, all moral authority derives from God and from His moral character. If it does not derive from God's character, from His government, then it's a usurped authority, it's an arbitrary authority. And the first one that got that going was the devil. And you can read about that in Isaiah 14, 13 and 14. The devil was the first one. He decided that he was going to set up a government that would be outside of God's authority and that he would be like God. And that's what the problem is with Antichrist. And that's what the problem is with clergy who tell the parishioners that they have to believe and do whatever they say. Notice where the true authority of the clergy comes from. Look in your Bible in 1 Corinthians. No, or is it 1 Corinthians? I'll have to check real quick. Yes, it is. It's 1 Corinthians 11. Here is where the true authority of the clergy comes from. Paul had authority, and he commanded things. And notice where the authority comes from. This is a command. 1 Corinthians 11, verse 1. Imitate me, just as I also imitate Christ. Paul said, I'm imitating Christ. And if you look at me, you'll be able to see what Christ is like. So you need to imitate me because I am imitating Christ. Did Paul have authority? He had a lot of authority. What gave him his authority? The thing that gave him his authority was his Christ-like character and that he was filled with the Holy Spirit. That's what gives authority in the church. We don't have time this morning to look at the principles of church organization, but one of the first principles of New Testament church organization, before you select anyone as a leader that will have influence in the church, one of the first questions you ask, and you can find this in Acts 6, is this person filled with the Holy Spirit? Are they demonstrating a Christ-like character? That's the question that has to be asked. Now, we could look at many verses to show how this principle was turned around so that people were taught that the church, parents, preachers had arbitrary authority and you just had to do whatever they said.
And any time, I want to say this as kindly as I can, because I don't want to hurt anybody. But I want us to learn the truth. In my home, if I exercise arbitrary authority, remember, arbitrary authority is when I tell you, you do it because I said so, and I have a position and power, so you do it because I said so. If I do not have a moral reason for my request, am I acting like God or the devil? Let's get it straight. Who is it that's arbitrary? Who is it? It's not God. Never, ever. That's the devil. That's what the devil does. And if I exercise arbitrary authority, who am I imitating? The devil. If I am developing a godly or godlike character, everything that I request will have a moral reason. It'll be based, and anything that has a moral reason will be based on God's Word. Because this is the book that tells you what is moral and what is immoral. This is the book that guides your mind to understand the difference between right and wrong. Moral authority always has a moral reason. And once I got a hold of that concept, I'll tell you, this can help you with all kinds of decisions in your daily life. Before you request something of somebody, ask yourself this question. What is the moral reason that I'm making this request? You'd be surprised. If you can't think of the moral reason right away, well, something is wrong. If you're going to make the request, you should know immediately what the moral reason is. What is the reason that's based on the Word of God that I'm making this request? Moral authority always has a moral reason. If the authority is only because of a person's position or power, then it's arbitrary. Any arbitrary command without a moral reason is satanic. It is part of Antichrist. It's not part of Christ at all. And I need to say here, this is one of the biggest problems, not just in the church, but in the world at large. It's one of the biggest reasons for the fracture of society and the family. Because people can't figure it out. It looks to them like everything they're told to do or not to is arbitrary. They can't figure out the moral reason for it. And so they just throw out the whole thing. That's one of the biggest reasons for the hippie movement that began in 1963. Young people could not figure this question out. It just looked like a bunch of arbitrary rules and regulations. So they just said, I'm going to throw the whole thing out. Religion and everything. Now this is a question that historic Adventists are asked often, because we are asked this question. People say to us, why are you not in submission to properly constituted church authority? I have a church over here and you don't do what I say and you don't do what I say. Why are you not in submission? Well, the New Testament teaches that we are to be in submission. In fact, let's just look at that so that we don't... We are all to be in submission. Look at Ephesians 5. Look at Ephesians 5, verse 21. It says in verse 21, submitting to one another in the fear of God. Our submission is in the fear of God. That's the way children are to obey their parents, in the Lord. That's the way that the wives are to be in submission to their husbands, for the same reason. Maybe we didn't read that one. Look at Colossians 3. Colossians 3:18 says, wives, submit to your own husbands as what? As is fitting, that is, as is appropriate in the Lord. See, no other human being has absolute authority like God has. We submit to one another in the fear of God. Now, historic Seventh-day Adventists submit our reason. We submit to moral authority only. But remember, moral authority always has its basis in where? In the Word of God. Moral authority always has its basis in the Word of God.
And that's why many times when Christians have been told, and this is going on around the world, people say, why don't you submit yourself to the judgment of the church? People say, I want to. Show me from the Bible that that's what I'm supposed to do or not supposed to do, and people can't show them. So we say, well, if that's the case, I have to submit to the moral authority of God's Word first. Now, I wish we had time this morning to cover the second two. Remember, the devil tells people that God is three things, that really he's like that. God's not like that at all. The first one is arbitrary. God's never arbitrary. Never has been, never will be. What are the second two? That God is severe. And the third one is what? He's unforgiving. Let me just mention what it means to be severe just for a moment. I have been amazed as I have read inspired writings to find out, and I have found evidence of this over and over. I'm not going to give you a whole study because we need to close. But I have found over and over again when God finds it necessary to punish somebody because of their wickedness, it could be a person or it could be a nation or it could be a church, I found that over and over the inspired writer makes a statement like the following. This was a statement that was made in regard to the destruction of Jerusalem in Jeremiah's time. Because of their wickedness, the inspired writer says, this was the lightest punishment that could be inflicted. What does that mean? He could have made the punishment worse, but that was the lightest punishment that could be inflicted and solved the problem. Now, there's a principle there that we need to study, but we can't study this morning. If we're becoming godlike and we have to punish our children, what are we going to be asking ourselves? What's the question we ask in our mind? What is the lightest punishment that I can give that will solve the problem and correct the behavior? What's the lightest punishment that I can get that will solve the problem? Not what's the most heavy punishment I get. That's being severe. That's the way the devil is. See, the devil would kill a fly with a sledgehammer. God doesn't work that way. Now, I want you to see one more thing before we close. And that is, even though God has absolute moral authority, He exercises His authority with gentleness and loving kindness. And this is something, if we are parents or if we are in a position of authority, that we need to learn, all of us, if we're going to become godlike. God exercises His authority with gentleness and loving kindness. Let's just read a text or two on that in closing. Look first of all at Jeremiah 9. Jeremiah 9, verses 23 and 24. Thus says the Lord, let not the wise man glory in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man glory in his might. Nor let the rich man glory in his riches. But let him who glories glory in this, that he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord, exercising loving kindness, judgment and righteousness in the earth, for in these things I delight, says the Lord. Oh, friend, do you know Him? Do the people around you know that you know Him? If you want something to delight in, God says, delight in the fact that you know me, that I exercise loving kindness and righteousness and judgment in the earth. These are the things that I delight in, says the Lord. Don't be fooled by the devil, friend, to think that God ever does anything arbitrary or that he's severe or unforgiving. That's the way the devil is. That's the way Antichrist is. It's not the way God is. And it's not the way his people are going to be whom he's going to take to heaven. And I want to go there one of these days, do you? I want to be with the person that's altogether lovely. Here's the last text. Look at Matthew 11.
verses 28 to 30. Jesus is speaking. He doesn't come to us with a gun. He doesn't come to us with a 2x4 or with a whip or with a club or with a law or anything that is forceful. This is the way Jesus attracts people to himself. Notice what he does. He says, "Come to me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." Jesus says, "Come to me. I'm gentle. I'm lowly. You'll find rest for your soul. It's easy. My burden is light. Come to me." Oh, friend, if you come to him, you're going to find it's wonderful. He'll do you good. It'll get better and better. The longer you walk with him, the better it's going to get. When I preached about these things the first time in California, some people came to me after and they said, "You need to make this more practical." And I thought I was making it practical. So I said, "Well, I'll try. I'll see if I can make it practical tonight." Let's kneel in prayer as far as we can and ask the Lord to give us a heart to come to him. Father in heaven, we give you thanks that you are a God that exercises loving kindness, and that everything that you ask us to do or not to do is always for our good every time. We give you thanks that you are not severe or unforgiving, but that you have made a way to redeem us back to yourself, that we may not be banished forever. We give you thanks for Jesus, our Savior, who demonstrated your character to us. And we pray that your Holy Spirit will change our hearts, save us from every satanic trait in our character. Deliver us, we pray, from an arbitrary character or spirit. Save us from our tendency as human beings to be severe with each other and to be unforgiving. We pray that you will deliver us from all of these satanic things, and that your Holy Spirit will come into our hearts and change us into the image of our Redeemer, that we might learn to think the way he thinks and talk the way he talks and live the way he lives, so that one day very soon we may go to that place, that home that he is preparing for all those that are undefiled. We pray in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen.
Here I am. What am I supposed to do? Not a clue of what to do with this mountain in my way. All this time I have followed in your steps, waiting here, how I have wept, so unsure of what you'd have me do. I am weary of this rocky path. I am weary of the way. Now mountain looms to hinder me, and the raging sea in front of me. It is faith that moves the mountain. can kneel. Though with man things may seem impossible, there is nothing you can't do, and there's victory for me in you. Though the path be ever weary, though the way is blocked from view, though the mountains loom to hinder me, you can clear the cold.